is my pleasure this morning, and it will be yours in a minute, to welcome our beloved Reverend John, and I welcome Reverend Michael back. Both are coming back from a well-deserved holiday. Now we know, you see I look handsome and relaxed. He's going to bring us some words of enlightenment, of inspiration, words that will lead us into pathways of joy and peace and love and light. Please help me welcome Reverend John.
Good morning, family. And it's a joy to add my own words of welcome and a real joy to be back home with you all. I didn't miss you because I knew you were here keeping the Temple of Light light burning brightly. I want to say a special word of thanks to you, though, for doing that, and to Reverend Ann Shand and the Temple crew, and in fact, all of the people who keep the light burning constantly. There were two high points to my vacation. The first was the absolutely beautiful wedding of one of our former Temple teens, Sophia Chisholm, daughter of Tony and Noel Chisholm. Noel is there. And sister of Paul, who remained in the teens workshop until he was 35. There's something deeply satisfying for me in seeing our young people grow into adulthood firmly grounded in truth. And our young adults were well represented at the wedding, as Hanif Lalu and Christina Carty filled the Prospect Chapel in Ocheres with their beautiful voices. And Auntie Carmen Clark was major domo, moving camels and cars to the right position, because it was on the Prospect Estate. There were camels. And Theo Smith of Great House Caterers, also a Temple teen of yesteryear, fed the 200 guests sumptuously. So it was just wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. The groom cried, and so did the pastor. The second peak experience of my vacation, as simple as it might seem, was that I watched the Olympics. All of it. I know we have friends here who were there in person, and I watched the television to see if I could find one little glimpse of some gray, moonlight-colored hair. Couldn't find any or one bald-headed man named Doug. Couldn't see them at all, but we saw the flags in the stadium, so we know they were there flying the flag high. But I watched everything. Now, normally I only watch, like, track and field, of course. And I love gymnastics, so I watched that and some synchronized swimming. This time I watched everything, even Greco-Roman wrestling, and I don't like pugilistic sports. As I watched the athletes, two things occurred to me. I thought, wow, you know, I'm on a quest to improve my spiritual vibrancy, to discover more of my spirituality. And I thought, look at how hard they work. Day in, day out, month in, month out, year in, year out. And I can barely squeeze in an hour a day to do the work I need to do to increase my spiritual muscles. So I watch them compete, and sometimes, you know, they push themselves to the limit of their endurance. And I just reflected on how wonderful it is that human beings can spend hours and hours of training, that they invest that in their bid to stand on the podium and watch their country's flag fluttering in the breeze. Every competitor, whether victorious or not, has a personal history. You know, and it's wonderful if you hear you hear the stories of those that get gold, silver, and bronze, but all of them come with a story, stories of overcoming, stories of challenges, sometimes stories of injury that they have overcome, stories of disappointments and then triumphs. Stories of overcoming, really, eh? And isn't it true that all of us have a personal story? All of us have a story on our journey, and some of us are working harder at getting to that podium, whatever our podium may be, to our dream, to what we want to attain. Some of us think we're too old and we're past it. Never admit it and never give in. It's true for all of us. We all have a personal story. So I've entitled my encouragement this morning, "What's Your Story?" Author David Brazier explores the humanity of the Buddha in a book titled The Feeling Buddha. And in a chapter called The Big Story, Brazier writes, and I quote, "What story are you living? What kind of story is it? Is it a story you will feel glad you have lived? Will you, when old, look back over the years without regret? Many people feel as though their lives haven't really begun yet. They are waiting for the right conditions to begin. Others feel as though it is all over already. And some feel a sense of purpose, while many others feel that their lives are disjointed, inconsequential, or seriously compromised," unquote. Brazier makes the point that in every life, there's a big story and there's a little story. Our little story is all about our egos, our possessions, what work we do, where we live, and what kind of car we drive. The little story is invariably told with the emphasis on attachments we have made, the appearances we have created, the gains or losses we have experienced, and the wounds that others have inflicted upon us. Not true. In other words, our little story is all about the facts of our life rather than being about the truth of our radiant spiritual heritage, the truth of who we really are, God's beloved expressions, God's beloved creations, endowed with all that we need to triumph and to be champions in the game of life. Oh my goodness, I just saw Liz. Welcome, Liz. How wonderful to see you. So the big story, well, you know, the little stories, sadly, keep us glued to the television, don't they? Obsessed with the facts of the latest scandal. It's the little stories that mesmerize the fans of soaps like The Young and the Restless and Days of Our Lives. Because nothing is wrong with them either, they're entertaining. But the little stories are all about the strivings and the pain. The big story is not about how we struggled and died, my friends. It is rather about our divine origins. It's about how we live and how we enrich our world. The big story emphasizes our inherent greatness and our wholeness, our beauty, and our perfection. It focuses on our divine purpose and the passion that we bring to whatever is our divine purpose and what we want to achieve in life. That's the big story. History is, of course, full of stories of people who were able to rise above the little story of their lives and to live the big story of their sacred dharma or divine purpose. In The Feeling Buddha, Brazier contends that even Jesus of Nazareth had a little story. The little story of the way-shower, according to Brazier, is that he was a carpenter's son who never managed to get himself either a wife or a decent job. This itinerant preacher finished up being betrayed by a friend and was executed for what was really a minor offense. But as we know, the big story was entirely different. It was a big story. A big deal. You know, one of the downsides of watching the Olympics, oh, by always, that I learned every ad. Best dressed chicken are the favorite. Me no want you forget. Yes. Now, I know that it has been argued that the date given for his birth and the details of his life were plagiarized from the ancient pagan myths. And some have even questioned whether there was an historic Jesus at all. But to me, it's neither here nor there. For me, what is important is the message of the big story. And the truth it underscores that every single person is truly divine. Can we just say it together? I am divine. I am. And can you imagine if you said that to your friend, your spouse, your partner, you are divine. And they think, wow, okay, what is he coming with? What am I doing wrong now? But the truth is, we are divine. So for me, that is the important big story. And the little story diminishes and denigrates and dismisses, but the big story expands and transcends and brings hope and brings the kind of joy we feel when we see our athletes just excelling on the world stage. And not just athletes, but you know, we have a tendency all as a nation to excel in every field of human endeavor. And it really is just, it's a big deal. It's a big story that when we set our sights on something, we really go for it with all our hearts, our minds, our souls. Can you imagine if we put that kind of energy into creating a world that really truly works for everyone? Can you imagine if we could put aside petty differences and just embrace the fact that we are a big deal? Isn't that just, can we just say we are a big deal?
We are a big deal.
Say, I have the heart of a champion. So the question I want to put before you this morning is, which story are you personally living? Take a stock, my friends, of how you usually describe yourself. Do you continually tell a story of lack and limitation? Are you a master teller of the hard luck story? And if your answer is yes, my friends, you are selling yourself short. Begin today to think about how you can channel your life into the service of a big story that will help to make the world a better place. That's what you're here to do. You're here to make the world a better place for each and every person that you encounter, including yourself. One of my personal role models was the comedian, the late comedian George Burns, who had bookings for appearances well beyond his 100th birthday. Burns is quoted as saying, "Retire? I'm going to stay in show business until I'm the only one left." I mean, I promise you that with ministry, though. Similarly, Norman Vaughan, the last surviving member of the 1928 expedition to Antarctica, passed away just before his 100th birthday. Vaughan had intended to climb the mountain named after him to celebrate his centennial. But hear this, because he was in a wheelchair, six guides would have been employed to pull him up the mountain. That's really determination, don't you think? People like Burns and Vaughan are no more exceptional as human beings than you and I are. They really were very ordinary folk with a strong desire to live life fully and out loud. And as students of the science of mind, we know that what we believe about ourselves makes a big difference in how we live our lives. The truth is, we are all ordinary folk capable of living big, big stories. At the very core of our beings is the immutable and inexhaustible source of all good. And we come, as I said earlier, fully equipped. We're a fully equipped package to live that story and to allow it to transform the world around us. And we didn't create these gifts. They are inner gifts. We only get a chance to express them or not. This is the lesson behind the story of the talents in Matthew 25, verses 14 to 30, which illustrates the tragedy of wasted opportunity. And you all know the story. Two of the servants doubled the talents entrusted to them, but the third, being fearful, buried the one given to him. And in verse 29, Jesus articulates a law, and I quote, "For unto everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance." That's the law. "To everyone that hath shall be given, and he shall have abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away even that which he hath," unquote. And I used to think this is really a cruel thing for Jesus to have said. You mean to say everybody that has get more, and those that don't have the little bit them have gets taken away? Until I understood, Dr. Elmer explained it to me one Sunday. She said, "John, it means that to him that has a consciousness of abundance, you get more abundance." It's how the law works. You attract to you what story you are living. And the person that doesn't have a consciousness of abundance a consciousness of their self-worth, a consciousness of the beauty of life, a consciousness of the wholeness that is theirs by divine right of being. What happens is, the universe says you don't think you're worthy, well, you're not, Sitya. And the little bit that you were holding on to just peters out and goes away. So to him that hath shall be given more, pressed down, shaken together, and running over into your lives. Can we say, I have a consciousness of abundance together? No wonder our late founding minister, Dr. Elmer Lumsden, used to say, look here, life is a school and we're not on holiday. We really can't afford to waste the opportunity to write a meaningful story for our lives, friends. I'm going to make you do some writing this week, too. Some people feel, for a variety of reasons, that they have missed the opportunity for their own big story. And so they throw their energy into living vicariously through their children, their grandchildren, and even public figures. But the truth is, it is never too late to begin living your own big story. Dr. Ernest Holmes, whose little story was that he was a dropout from school, and whose big story is the gift to the world of this teaching known as the science of mind, writes in his textbook of the same, by the same name, and I quote, "There is a law of unfoldment in man which says he can advance only by going from where he is to the place where he would like to be. The way to work is to begin right where we are," unquote. And I laughed when I read it again because I said, well, there is Bolt at this, on the starting block, and he is going from where he is to where he wants to be on the gold medal podium. But if you blink, you miss it. Don't blink, because that's it. That's how quickly it happens. So years ago, I came across this exercise in mind power that yielded great and dramatic results for me. And about 7 years ago, I gave it as an assignment, and I want to give it to you again today. It is a 3-week assignment, or if you prefer, it's a 21-day challenge known as the 21 by 21 exercise. How many of you remember it? The 21 by 21 exercise is this. It's based on the premise that your mind will move in the direction of your most dominant thoughts. And you all know that. And that what you expect, you tend to realize. I believe it was Albert Einstein who said, and I quote, "Imagination is more powerful than knowledge," unquote. It is true that an idea placed into your subconscious mind will remain there until it is replaced by another idea. And this is why mental habits of thinking must be changed before outer behavior can be altered. That's the work that Reverend Michael Record and I are doing in the prison at Tower Street here in Kingston. And this is the work that Reverend Anne Shand and practitioner Carol Charlton will be doing in the women's prison beginning in October, because we have received permission to go into the women's prison as well. So here is your 21 by 21 exercise. It works because handwriting goes directly to the right brain, which it is believed is connected to the subconscious mind. Now, you can't do it on the computer, you have to write. There's a neurological link between writing, W-R-I-T-I-N-G, and writing, R-I-G-H-T-I-N-G. Saying an affirmation or writing it once has little effect, but repeating it over a period of 3 weeks will produce astonishing results. So your assignment, should you decide to undertake it, is the following. 1, develop a positive affirmation. Remember to write it in the present tense and to be specific and exact. Also, when writing your affirmation, use obtainable goals, otherwise you will be working against your own belief system. Let me share some of the affirmations that have worked for me. I am God's instrument of love, peace, joy, and prosperity. Can we say that? I am God's instrument of love, peace, joy, and prosperity. Another one. I choose joy in the morning, joy in the afternoon, and joy in the evening. Together? I choose joy in the morning, joy in the afternoon, and joy in the evening. Joy is my natural state of being.
Joy is my natural state of being.
Don't you glad you come this morning? God as me is the author of my big story. Together? God as me is the author of my big story. I am living a powerful story of personal awakening and accomplishment. I am living a big, personal, powerful story of personal awakening and accomplishment. I have the heart of a champion. I have the heart of a champion. And with God as my trainer, I am a winner in the game of life. And with God as my trainer, I am a winner in the game of life. So you see, tomorrow morning when it's time to get up and do your spiritual practice, just imagine your coach saying, come, get up. You need to do the work. It takes work. So the second thing I want you to do is, having decided on a positive affirmation for yourself, this is the challenge. You're going to handwrite it 21 times every night just before going to bed for 21 nights. 21 times 21. So every night for 21 nights, you're going to write out your affirmation 21 times. And if possible, say it aloud while you are writing it. So don't be like my friend who says, God help me live with this man, do. Because then he will think, huh? Say, I live with a wonderful partner and all is well. Good. Visualize or imagine the completed result you desire and act as though it's already true. We know that. You know, once you set an intention, act as if it's true, because it is already true in the mind of God on the unseen side. And imbue your affirmation with as much positive feeling as you can. Feel it, experience it at a deep level, and just live it. 21 days, 21 times every night, writing your affirmation. Finally, be persistent, be diligent with your practice, and watch for the results. And every time you feel like slacking off, think about our athletes and go for gold. Friends, as students and practitioners of the science of mind, each of us has the opportunity to write and to live a really big story that is part of the bigger story of humanity's divinity. Each of us is like a chapter in that book of life that says we are here to succeed, we are here to win, we're here to be a blessing to our fellow human beings and a joy to our God. That's our divine dharma, that's our purpose, that's why we came, to enrich this world with our presence. Isn't that a wonderful assignment? Can you imagine if we could do that with the same diligence that a bull puts into his training? Wow, and we don't need any kind of other assistance but our own determination, our own will. So that thy will be done. Let us say, my will is being done because my will is God's will. And therefore it must be. My will is being done because my will is God's will. It's being done because my will is God's will. Eric Butterworth tells how he once heard a preacher say, Jesus challenged men with unattainable goals, unquote. The fact is, of course, those goals are impossible, according to Butterworth. The preacher said, those goals are impossible for weak, sinful humans to attain. And so, you know, for such a long time, we've been told that we're weak and sinful. You're not tired of it. Enough already. You know, that negates the truth that the master teacher came, that every single seer and prophet and holy person of every religion in every age has come to say, we are divine, we are gods, we are the fruit of a tree that is so absolutely amazing that if we could just embrace the truth of ourselves, we would soar to higher and higher heights of accomplishment. We would live a big story to the honor and glory of God. And so as you sit to do your 21 by 21 exercise beginning this evening, remember the invitation of the master in Matthew 25, verse 34. And I quote, come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Come, ye blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Can you imagine if we wrote 21 times every night, I claim my inheritance of the kingdom which was established for me from the beginning of time by the creator of all that is and ever will be. Wow! Now make the affirmation too long, because there are 21 times you have to write it. But that, my friends, is your big story. Live it to the honor and glory of God. God loves you, and so do I. Namaste.